very late in the evening. I'm sure everyone is tired. I think in my teaching, I would just do a lot of wrap-ups of stuff that have been discussed throughout the day. I have a couple of slides, and then we will have like a very interactive discussion on ways by which scientists can show solidarity across border and international. Because I will just begin by something very important. So I'm Ahmed Hady, I'm a neuroscientist, and I think a lot about specifically militarization of science. I have spoken a lot about the military investment in neuroscience for some time now. The point is that the event that we are having today is not just because of Trump, but it's just a culmination of trends that have been happening for some time. So it's very important for me as a scientist to declare, you know, that science and scientists do not exist in some isolated ether, that they just find like, some objective truths. So science exists, is an integral part of the society, and it exists as an establishment within the society. How it is, you know, that's my own thought about it. People can have different opinions, but science as an establishment is heavily shaped by the socio-political system and economical system of the society we live in. And it produces technologies that perpetuate back this same economical and socio-political system. And there are very important trends, before I go on science, that affect how science is shaped recently. So, what are these trends? So, the rise of, I would say, okay, you know, I think that we have a strong rise in neo-fascist and neo-nationalist movement, not only in the US, but across the globe. In Europe, it's the same, in the Middle East, and in the United States. Increased militarization of technology, a lot of scientists have been involved in research funded by military, but now they are really opposed to Trump. So my question to them is that, what were you thinking while getting military funding for science? There are other three important trends shaping the nation state, which is a technocratic state, means a high reliance on experts or technocrats, which mostly use scientific knowledge in order to shape society. The other two states are very, very intertwined, emergency state and the surveillance state. So recently, you know, emergency states have been declared in France, previously in the United States, as part of war on terror. During this emergency state, you use very advanced surveillance technology, which definitely scientists have contributed to develop. Another important trend is the increased capitalist appropriation of science, which means the heavy corporate investment in science and useful or translational science. The other trend, which I call cognitive capitalism, which is, you know, we have moved. Another trend is what I call cognitive capitalism, which is, you know, in the usual Marxist tradition, you will just talk about the worker as a worker in the factory. But now, the cognitive workers, which is the intellectual workers, are also part of the exploited class. Because first, you can ask any scientist, salaries are almost allow you to live an okay life, or precarious life. So it created a class of workers or scientists who live precarious life. You know, I can go on a lot. I just wanted to look at to state some of the trends that are not only affecting the United States, but these are global trends. The other thing, the scientists have always been political or militarized subjects. So this tendency of scientists always to reject, we are not political, we science is away from politics, I think is totally false. Scientists have always been involved in politics, and even if they don't are directly involved in politics, either their knowledge or the resources they use are shaped by politics. So these trends, you know, is not happening only in the United States, but these are global trends affect any global scientists, global community. So just to, you know, part of the work I have done before on the neuroscience funding. So, you know, there is a big initiative that US have initiated for as a way for federal neuroscience funding. The initiative first had $50 million. It increased because of pressure from the IARPA and DARPA, who actually share 50% of this amount of money, because there have been many reports, you can check these two reports, on committees in the Congress that have highlighted the neuroscience importance for military and intelligence. These trends have been happening all the time, and there have been no dissent against scientists. The usual line of argumentation is, this is not a direct weapon. It's good that you take this money so that they don't spend it on other, real weapons like airplanes and others. But I think these are very worrying trends and will increase in the coming years. So when we hear scientists saying that science is under attack under Trump, I think it is right in a way, but wrong in so many ways, because science have been under attack way before in terms of military interests and corporate interests specifically. The other trend that I think is very important as a neuroscientist, which I find deeply disturbing, this neuro-everything. You know, you can Google every term of this and you will find whole institution about it and whole work. And this arrogance of scientists declaring their method as superior to humanity, social sciences, anthropological sciences. So the it's part of this technocratic state that I talked about, that you need to, because natural sciences are more precise, so they need to get into other domains of life. I will just put a quote from the Center for Neuropolicy at Emory University. So, that, oh, sorry.
Because you stepped up.
Yeah. I'm not stepped. Alert me if I stepped. So, we just read this. The real problems are human nature and difficulty in getting 6 billion people to do anything. Collective decision making is political, but politics are biological. And you know, if you okay, the argument will be, yeah, but they are trying to get funding and stuff like this. But I think these are very disturbing ideological commitments that here you try to reduce everything into some biological mechanism, which might be true, might not be true, but it has its own repercussion in terms of politics. So, and no mention of external factors, economical like capitalism, or any socio-political extended factors. And you get out studies like this one, red brain and blue brain. So this have led to a trend, so people are now, you know, shocked by that Trump will defund arts and humanities, but this trend have been going on for some time. For example, I will quote from a speech for Shinzo Abe, the Japanese Prime Minister, because he decided to stop humanities and social science research in Japan, saying rather than deepening academic research, the design is theoretical, we will conduct more practical vocational education that better anticipates the needs of society. So, to say that science is under attack just now, I say no. I think scientists have been complicit into some of the trends that we are seeing now in terms of the militarized state, in terms of the technocracy that plays a big role in increasing inequality. So this is to say that, you know, scientists should join the resistance, and one can decipher some common struggles that scientists can work on a global level. Because the scientists, you know, they travel everywhere, there is international collaboration, so I wouldn't only restrict it to American scientists, but I think there is a more international role for scientists. And here I will close the board. So I will begin to think, you know, I outlined a lot of the issues, a lot of political issues, economical issues, and how scientists can show solidarity across borders. So the first point in terms of international solidarity, and it has been a heated debate, is the academic boycott. So when a country is, you know, is politically involved in a lot of injustices, scientists can call for example, for an academic boycott. And that's a way by which scientists across the globe can apply pressure on a particular government by invoking the call for academic boycott. The most prominent case have been targeted against Israel, and there have been calls even after Trump that US academic institutions should be boycotted. So, how many scientists are in the audience? So, yeah, I want to like poll, how many would support an academic boycott against the countries that you think is involved in injustices, and why would you think so?
Can I just ask what you mean? Do you mean like read any papers from that country, you wouldn't invite speakers? What does it mean to do an academic boycott?
So, for example, in case of the academic boycott in Israel, it's boycotting institutions in order to end the occupation of the in Palestine.
And what does boycotting the institute mean?
Boycotting institute means that you don't participate in events funded by institutional money, but you deal with the individual directly. You don't boycott the individuals.
And you also don't go to that, to institutions in the US for further studies?
Yeah, I am. Yeah, that's, you can, you know, define how you want. I think it's up to the scientist, but a lot of it would be like you don't go to the US. For a lot of call for the boycott came after the travel ban executive orders and said, okay, we are not going to travel to conferences because our colleagues cannot come to these conferences.
Yeah, sure. I just want to say that some scientists think that the most open part of a society,
yes,
let's say in South Africa or in other societies like this, is the academic society.
Yes. Yes.
And if you boycott them, you isolate them while you want to bring them in.
Exactly.
So there is a lot of disagreement.
True.
On this issue, especially the academic boycott. There are people who think about and are willing to do some other kind of boycotts, but they think the academic boycott is the most, the thing to avoid, because you want to, you don't want to isolate that part of the population that can play a role in improving society.
I think it might even help these governments if you isolate their scientists and those bodies.
Yeah, I have been personally involved in events trying to bring Arab and Israeli scientists. So I'm undecided on the academic boycott. And I find it's hard to delineate where do you boycott the institution and the individuals. So it becomes a very hard issue. But at the same time, you don't want to to support institutions that are perpetuating injustices. So it become it has to be a very nuanced way to build such meetings between, for example, I would say what I have been involved in, Arab and Israeli scientists, because I find myself subject to maybe being used for some kind of propaganda.
Okay.
Some kind of propaganda.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I organized an event called Neurobridges, have been going on for 3 years to bring neuroscientists from Arab countries and Israel, not funded by Israeli institutions, and have been a very difficult for me to make everyone happy, which is, you know, you cannot do it, because those who support academic boycott see the event as normalizing occupation, which I don't think is true. And from the other side, some of the Israeli propaganda arms, government, the Hasbara, want to use the event in order to promote their own agenda. So it's a very difficult topic. And I think we will run into similar questions if the bans on Muslims or Arabs in United States becomes more aggressive. So we have to ask, okay, how can we not be complicit as scientists?
I also think that you should be careful not to make a general statement,
sure,
because it much depends on what you see that particular institution doing, what role it's
playing. Exactly.
If that particular institution is participating in furthering discrimination, then there's a call for boycott.
Exactly.
On the other hand, if they're resisting certain pressures,
yes,
then maybe you have to engage with them.
Yeah, so still, I think the academic boycott movement against Israel is developing towards this direction. I think they still have a lot of blanket judgments. And also I have issues with singling out a single country. I think there are other countries that have to be boycotted for their human rights abuse. For example, NYU Abu Dhabi is using workers, slave workers. NYU Shanghai, how do we relate to the Chinese government policies? So, and here scientists become a political subject. So are we just want to turn a blind eye and go to these countries without really caring about injustices that people are exposed to? So I think that's the advantage of scientists being part of an international community, is that they can form these connections and try to build coalitions. So I have personal experiences this in trying to bring Arab and Israelis together, and this is a very hard topic.
And then would an academic boycott be sustainable?
Yeah.
Because in the long run, you're ultimately going to be hurting science, your own work.
Exactly.
So
I agree on all those concerns. I just put it up as a topic, as a way by which people can show solidarity. I have tried in this event I'm organizing to be very careful not to target individuals, but also be conscious of the institutions that I'm dealing with. So if you want to check the event, it's called Neurobridges. I organized it in Europe just as a neutral, till now, neutral space, because we cannot meet in the Middle East and we cannot meet in the United States. So Europe have been welcome till now, but you never know.
But I think we should also ask the question, is it wrong to hurt science? I mean, science so sacrosanct that other things can be just neglected. Human rights, for example, right? And that's the purpose of any boycott. When I boycott, Cheerios or something like that, I might like Cheerios, and I'm putting myself in pain by boycotting. But, so what?
Is there any science to show that these boycotts work?
People cite the South Africa example, but I think it's a very different scenario. But it's I think economic divestment definitely worked, but academic boycott, I'm not sure whether it works or not.
Yeah, so maybe we should move on to something else.
Sure. And the second thing is, when I talk about the event I'm organizing, is that there are ways by which you can have what I call dual intent scientific events. which means, you know, scientists have acted as not only as scientists, but as also kind of diplomacy. This was very obvious in nuclear, you know, physics and nuclear disarmament. All the discussions between American scientists and Russian scientists happened beyond the state. It was because of the scientists wanted to connect. And such a scientific event would be very important in order to show solidarity, try to find ways by which, for example, if a certain group of scientists is oppressed in a country, they can go to another country. It was very obvious with, not in terms of events, but how a lot of scientists, like in the nuclear physics, there was the Einstein-Russell manifesto that have made a declaration that they are going to oppose any development of nuclear weapons. And in terms of technological applications, in terms of biological weapons or applications of neuroscience, such an international event might provide a place in order to create some kind of like manifestos for how scientists should act under a fascist regime and how they should not be complicit. Because historically we know in fascist regimes, like in Germany, how a lot of scientists were very much complicit in kinds of insurrection. And this has to be brought up before, you know, I think we will, I hope we learn again that we don't have to develop a nuclear weapon, then we ask the question, what is the scientist's responsibility? We might reach a similar point with artificial intelligence. And we have to ask ourselves, do we want killer robots? Do we want killer AIs or not? And this is part of the scientific event, should yes discuss science, but should also, in the same time, discuss long-term policy, society, and societal implications.
Would this also call for a change in the culture for scientists? Because, I mean, at least in the case of American scientists, they don't necessarily see themselves as political agents, right? So,
yeah.
I mean, right now there's a discussion on it because there's a feeling of oppression that's happening. Mm-hmm. But I don't think there's an understanding that scientists could also be enactors of these situations. Artificial intelligence is a great example of this.
Yeah. I think, you know, I have a... So it seems to me they will be pushed to be. So you'll have two types of scientists. You know, you already there is a lot of military funding for science, and some of what they call us radical scientists are always talking about it, like you should not accept military funding and others. But for others, it didn't reach the point of them being uncomfortable in terms of what they are doing to the society. Because you have to realize that people are, you know, most people are selfish, think about their own, you know, economical and societal interests. But I think now what we are seeing under Trump is that it begins to attack, his attacks are targeted towards the white middle class and the white elite in many ways. And this is why we see mobilization like the March for Science. Whether it will lead to politicization of scientists, we will see on the long term. I'm not very much optimistic, but we will see on the long term. Because you will have some scientists giving up and collaborating with the state, and some will be dissidents. But how do you deal with the dissident scientists?
Well, but that's a part of the question too. I mean, right now we're complaining because of the threats of funding being cut.
Yeah.
But we didn't complain when we had funding, even if it's from these agencies that are doing these things.
Exactly. Exactly.
So,
and then NSF, for example, is adding now a requirement that you have to write a national interest form, which was required for DARPA and the defense agencies, but now you have to rationalize why it's important for the United States of America.
So this is different from what was there before, that you had to say general interest, not national interest.
Yes, exactly.
So different?
It's very different because national general interest, this is like, you know, as scientists, we want to contribute to science, to humanity.
Yes.
But here, this is national interest, what it will do good for America.
This is new?
Yeah, they just 2 weeks ago, the NSF requires this form. You got to check it. And it is discussing with the Congress, but the fact that it is being discussed, this is a very alarming fact. That it's the same what you do with defense grants, you will have to do them with NSF and other grants. And it's not surprising.
We can also, we will make America great.
So it's not surprising because exactly part of the agenda you just said is, you know, make America great again. And this is a very touchy topic because fascist regimes are known to, you know, instrumentalize all the apparatus of the state for their own service. So I don't think his attack on science, you know, will last, as a scientist say. I think he will instrumentalize them to serve his own good. And I'm very sure a lot will contribute. You know, we, after the 9/11 as an example, after the Patriot Act, a lot of scientists have contributed a lot to the eavesdropping algorithms, to the surveillance technologies we are using, and you tell them, oh, but, you know, this is to fight the bad guys. Okay, but what if you become the bad guy? So this is a question they never asked, that the state terror will be targeted towards them.
The torture in Guantanamo Bay.
The torture in Guantanamo, based on psychologists we know very well, is in University of Pennsylvania, being filmed, so I don't want to say the name. Exactly, so a neuroscientist that we might meet in a conference have advised the CIA on waterboarding. So, where, you know, what are we doing? You know, it's so when I hear a lot of whinings that you are under attack, I think, okay, maybe we are getting a bit of punishment of what we have been doing. So going to the dissidents, a couple of points I will go on is, you know, we need to think of alternative funding schemes. You know, either crowdsourcing, citizens who are, you know, all these people who went to the march, if they donate money, or people begin to have alternative, you know, we have to, alternative funding schemes will be very important for anyone who is dissenting from such a system. It's very important to provide a network of support for them. It comes into, again, this is where international solidarity is very important, so creating funding across countries to help people move more quickly if they are, you know, kicked out by their institutions. It's very important for scientists to show this type of solidarity. This goes into the other point, is the point of academic freedoms. You know, and this is for me is, you know, I grew up in Egypt, and I have been very much involved also during the revolution. And we had one case of an Italian researcher who was working on anthropology of worker rights in Egypt. He was kidnapped by the Secret Service, killed, and thrown into the street. How did the his government did not react much because they wanted to, you know, stay friends with Sisi, our, you know, military dictator. But how does the scientific community react by them? This is very important. Like, what do we do? How do we condemn this? How do we apply pressure on such oppressive countries? The situation is not as bad as it is now, but we have to think of the future. There are people in power, some of them are bullies and big bullies and want such an agenda. Thanks, here there is institutions that prevent this from happening, but are these institutions going to last forever? Nobody knows. So it's very important to think in terms of how to protect dissident scientists within the frame of providing alternative funding scheme and the frame of academic freedom. Because, you know, in the morning, I attended this talk by William Harper. And he is up for becoming the advisor on environmental issues to the current president. And he's a climate change denialist.
want more than that. He wants to increase carbon emissions.
Yeah, he thinks carbon emission is very useful and he wants to increase it. So we are up for, and he put all of his opinions under some time of academic freedom. So where do we draw the line for a freedom that will have a disastrous, might have a disastrous impact on the society and world? I think that's very important to discuss. The talks about this type of McCarthyism that Trump wants to go back to it, like in the 50s, you had the Committee on Un-American Activities, which used to hunt all the communists in the academia and list them. And there is now a list online for academic, I forgot the website, there was for the leftist academics. No, not the Canary Mission. So Canary Mission is one. The Canary Mission puts online the names of all professor intellectual who support the academic boycott. But there is another list for leftist professors who are put online to defame them. So they might return, it's not new to the US, but they might come to a more vicious form of hunting academic freedoms. And how does the international community of scientists react to this? How can we protect them? These are very open questions that we have to think about. Another, you know, I will move gears a bit, is what I call resistance science. So, you know, resistance science is a term I don't know if it exists or not, I came up with. There are two very important things that scientists or more technically able people can contribute to. It's normalizing cryptography. I know that there is a crypto party now happening, so helping people to protect themselves. So in such when we are entering into a such era, that already there have been surveillance, but the surveillance state will be expanded. And how does people protect themselves? I think encryption should be part of the formal education of anyone. How to protect your data, how to protect yourself, because it might be weaponized against you. How it will be weaponized, I think you can just Google the weaponized narratives project. And it had also, so we have to be very aware that our digital existence will be used against us, will be used to manipulate us, and have been used in the propaganda up to the election to Trump. There is a company called Cambridge Analytica, where Steve Bannon have been on the board, and they do very massive social media analytics and targeted propaganda. So scientists have a lot of knowledge with this. A lot of people in computer science, a lot of people in information technology should be on the forefront of pushing the idea of cryptography should be totally normalized and should be user-friendly. Now it's not very user-friendly, but this is a very important topic. The other thing is, you know, a lot of people have, so the DIY movement, I think, is a very important movement, the DIY bio, the DIY neuro, that the citizen scientists, the people can assemble cheap materials and do their own experiments outside of the academia. The third thing.
What does DIY stand for?
Do it yourself.
Huh?
Do it yourself. So, I think that's a very important movement that gives opportunity to people who are not like formally researchers or even have PhDs to do their own experiments. So by this you increase science literacy and you create a more open discussion about science. The third thing is, you know, we weren't able, but I was discussing with an architecture student here how to architecture of the barricades. So architecture is a barricade. There is a lot of knowledge about how barricades are built and in order to resist police and state violence. In terms of when you have very large massive mobilization, how do we act and how do we organize? We have to prepare for the moment when there is a very large mobilization and when the state is going to use very extreme force against the protesters. Occupy have done some job, but I think we can optimize more with some scientific knowledge how we show dissent and how we fight against police violence. So there is a lot of knowledge in the academia, just more be more diffused to the public.
What are the lessons you learned this from the Egyptian Revolution?
From the Egyptian Revolution, there is a lot of lessons. I think occupying the square, so this whole Occupy movement made copies of occupying the squares, that you need a very central area of the capital in order to attract a lot of attention, and you build your tents and you have self-policing outside, people checking on people entering. It's a self-policing. I don't want to like idealize it, but I think it worked against a very brutal police who have almost only power, can kick people on stand. So this is one lesson, you know, large crowds, you create a very central, this kind of occupation, you know, occupy. But with more new technologies emerging, you need to know how can you protect people digital feeds in this area, because then the state begin to have they use Twitter in order to know who is where and begin to target them. In the United States, it had been used in Ferguson in large protests as they begin to target activists via social media. They know where you are and then they can arrest you. So it's very important also in this is that, you know, the back to the question is that the police is now heavily militarized. So the boundary between police and military is diluted. And we have to be very worried about it. Including Obama have passed the National Defense Authorization Act, which allows military to do law enforcement in a state of emergency. And what state of emergency mean? It's state of emergency. So it can be arbitrarily declared. We when the Boston Marathon happened, the guys who exploded the bomb declared a state of emergency means anyone in the street can be killed, can be targeted, everything is watched. So we have to be very vigilant to the upcoming threats, the militarization of police and the arbitrary use of the emergency state laws. And the legal infrastructure exists. This is in the United States. You know, in Egypt, you can trust, we had a state of emergency for 50 years.
Do you think it'll come to that here?
Maybe. So we need to, you know, the lesson learned from Trump, we need to be dark in our thinking, that the worst might happen. And we just need to prepare to it. The issue is that, what are you losing for preparing for it? So the lesson from Trump win is that the worst might happen. And it might get worse. So it is not there yet, but he's targeting his whole, Steve Bannon, for example, is the big ideologue. Mm-hmm. His idea is to deconstruct institutions. He wants to go there. Whether he can or not, might not. But should we wait till it's all lost? So that's a, you know, that's a point I have. Yeah, it might not. It doesn't seem that it's going. But the rhetoric, this is where they want to go. Whether they will succeed or not, but there is maybe a small chance they will succeed. The same happened with his win. It was, you know, it was such a devastating result. It was, people were very confident he will not win, but he won. So we just need to be a bit dark there. It is not the brightest view, but I think it's very important to be vigilant. The other point is, you know, came up with the traffic ban. So the freedom of movement. So, okay, when the traffic ban came out, we had this big petition, academics against the traffic ban. It's a very good effort, but already scientists from these countries, including myself, many countries, their movements are restricted. So in a way, they don't have the same freedom of movement of what's called first world countries. They don't have the same freedom of movement. So the travel ban was just an exaggeration of policies already in place. And a lot, for example, of American colleagues were not aware that, for example, my visa takes 3 months to issue because of a lot of background check and that. So it brought to light the issue of freedom of movement and who is free to move and who is not free to move. So to pretend that, yes, the traffic ban is horrible and you should not block people, but it is a continuation of policy of border control. And this definitely affects science in many ways and the asymmetry of access to scientific knowledge and scientific evidence. The last 2 points, so I think one of these points Ramana talked about is the workers' movements. So we have effort here on campus for unionizing graduate students and postdocs, and this is very important. I think a lot of complaints about scientists is that they are elite and very, you know, very separate from, and they split themselves from the society. But, or even, you know, if you hear Trump supporters, white workers, differentiated, complaining about working conditions, but scientists are no better. So we are part of the same, under the same pressure of a very exploitative system where scientists have constantly temporary job unless they are very lucky and got tenure. And the efforts for unionizations are very important because it protects the rights, and not only protects the rights as workers, but it also will show solidarity with other worker movements outside of the academia. So we become one in some common struggle against the system that exploits us. So I see here the unionization as a very, very important effort, not only to protect the workers in the university, but also to show to others that we are like them. We are not this like snobby experts who want to show off all the time. So this is where, you know, I feel that worker movements are also a very important trend. I have not only been involved here in the unionization effort, but also in Germany, in the Max Planck Society. There is an effort for postdoc unionization, but in Germany it's easier because there is already a socialist tradition. In the United States, you know, workers, when once you say you want to do a union, it sounds like a communist conspiracy and people begin to go crazy about it. But I think it's a very important in these times to unionize, not only to preserve our rights, but to, you know, have larger coalition with workers outside the academy. Okay. The last point, humanities and social sciences. So I have repeatedly complained about the humanities and social sciences are seen by many, you know, in some political establishment, even natural scientists, as some kind of a useless endeavor, and we need to defund them because this is a waste of money. I think it's very important that we have a very strong stance on continuing funding for humanities and social sciences, because that's this is a knowledge that is very crucial to understand history, to understand our future, to understand our preconditions. So you can see, for example, the algorithm, a lot of people predicted the outcome of the elections. All were false. because there was no nuanced analysis for history, social precondition, economical factors that didn't count in these algorithms that would have been very, very crucial if we were careful about humanities and social sciences. Because this is running against the trend of, oh, let's educate all the children math and STEM knowledge. No, no, no. You want them to all learn math because they want to be technocrats afterwards in order to be productive citizens. And humanities and social sciences are always seen with a suspicion because this is where a lot of critical knowledge comes from. I think if you study math only since childhood, you become a zombie who doesn't even think. No, that's coming from somebody who is, you know, a natural scientist. But I think it's a very important to strongly defend humanities and social sciences, and natural scientists should stop attacking humanities and social sciences by saying, oh, it's not quantitative enough, it's not empirical enough. I think this should stop. Okay, sorry, but... So, any other... So this were, you know, my thoughts that came, how can scientists... These are, you know, international issues and global issues where scientists across many countries, not only the United States, can, you know, work together in order to oppose capitalism and improve meaning, improve social equality in the society. Second, in order to combat fascism. So, any other ideas on the table?
I just have a question. Going back to the do-it-yourself, I know this is kind of specific,
sure,
but how exactly would we encourage people to do that? Because I know a lot of people, I look online and you see all of this stuff and you see all this stuff that's just not true, or a lot of people think that they're doing proper research when they're not really, because like I know there's like a whole movement against vaccines, for example, and a lot,
sure,
of people say, oh, I have evidence that my child got got some mental autism from having a vaccine, but there's no, when you look at the evidence that they have, it's not proof, but they're presenting it as fact and as proof for their argument,
yeah,
and then,
yeah,
you see this false claim, like,
mm-hmm,
repeated over and over and over because just because of social media and those kinds of pathways. So how would you promote do-it-yourself science when a lot of people don't know how to do science properly?
I know good examples,
yes,
of scientists. So you can check something called the routine. The scientist is called Josh Zinar. It's a whole movement in the Bay Area where he has this, you know, he co-founded the biohacking conference. And he's a synthetic biologist who, you know, got fed up with the conventional NIH funding and went on and did a hub to do DIY bio-synbio. So he do CRISPR, you know, if you do CRISPR, he does. He prepared even bacteria from his own feces, like he do experiments on himself. He's a very great guy. And then there are bigger communities like this, and definitely you'll get people who are ignorant, but at least this you can discredit and remove them. The problem is that...
But the thing is, it's not discredited right now. A lot of people believe that, a lot of people, especially from my city, believe these
the vaccines.
Especially vaccines.
Yeah, but this have also a religious dimension, this have many dimensions.
Okay.
Where people, the anti-vaccine movement have always... Also in the evangelical community, some of it is like, are you interfering with God's will? It has a lot of religious also dimensions.
Okay. Well, the thing is, like, a lot of the people that I know that say these kinds of things are, so I'm very liberal, but they're like super, super liberal, and they're the ones who are quoting this. So they're, I don't know. Like, they say they're for science, they're for all of these things, and then they say this, and they're not really... I don't know. So they're not like doing it based off a religious belief in that sense.
But I think that the idea with do-it-yourself science isn't isn't to say that people don't feel like they're scientists when they see one instance of something, but to get people experience with, you know, sampling things several times, like actually looking at the empirical method and not weighing a single instance as much as they do if they didn't have exposure to that, basically. Like there are these like kits that you can get where you can practice on your lawn or you can take cockroaches and measure their brain activity or something like that.
Yes.
backyard.
The backyard things.
Yeah.
Well, getting people thinking and asking questions.
Yeah.
And checking for results.
Yeah, I think developing technologies in the DIY sphere is very important, and we should provide, you know, they should serve. This is why alternative funding schemes are very important for research that can not be done within the academic establishment.
I think early education as well, which is something that's being dismantled
mm-hmm.
here, is really important, because by the time people reach adulthood, in many cases, it's almost too late if you've been brought up in a particular way.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to break out of certain kinds of thinking. So that's really scary that early education is being dismantled.
Or
just promoting scientific method?
Yeah, I will be careful. You know, I'm always careful when somebody say promote some scientific method, because, yeah, promoting scientific method as conjunction with other methods. I'm just fed up of scientists promoting the superiority of scientific method. It is not superior. It is not superior to humanities or social sciences. It is a method to view life. It's very important, but we should not take it as the only legitimate manner.
The scientific method, I just mean like critical thinking.
Sure. It doesn't always imply this. Doesn't always imply this. It, you have to see, so it depends on where this scientific method is practiced. If it is practiced in Hitler's time, it was not critical. You know, Max Planck, other scientists were complicit. You know, Heisenberg, they were within a fascist establishment, they just doing their science. So now it did not promote critical thinking, but in other more socially aware regimes, you would have more critics. So this is why I said in the beginning that as science and scientists, we don't exist in some ether. We exist within a certain structure that give us the space to apply this method or use it. Either use it for critical thinking or use it to, you know, for other purposes. So you're right for the scientific method, but along with it, we should, this is why I here put a lot of things together. Economical justice, social justice, this all come together. Oh. They cannot be stopped.
But something you said too was to improve science literacy so that mm-hmm. people can then read articles that are being cited, you know, or yeah. in social media or being repeated
exactly.
by everyone and have an opinion on it. That's
exactly.
not just saying what the
yeah.
course stated.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Exactly. Having the scientific literacy is very important to have, you know, an ongoing discussion. It's very important. Sure.
I think there's another aspect which you want to sort of use critical thinking to understand why people are coming up with this position that, you know, vaccines sort of cause autism or vaccines are bad. And it doesn't come from, you know, some prejudged notion, but from seeing the fact that there is in many cases ways by which the medical and scientific establishment colludes with a whole bunch of practices which can be bad. And so that's kind of leads you to this paranoid, you know, other reaction where you kind of say, oh, everything they say is wrong, right? And so you have tried to get, you cannot sort of give a general answer. I think you sort of talk to individuals, sort of get deeper into this question and then get to that, rather than make a general assumption saying, you know, these guys have to just be taught the scientific method and immediately they're going to jump to that.
So I had just one thing I wanted to say. I think there's one sort of aspect of the problem now, I think, that like scientists face this sort of maybe slightly orthogonal, which is that this era of sort of post-truth where people think that knowledge is all, you know, very relative and, you know, this source is just as valid as that source. And I think that relates to, you know, the idea that, you know, you read a blog that says that vaccines cause autism, that's just as believable as something I read on the New York Times. And so I think, you know, one could make the argument that where if scientists become more overtly political, that has positives, but there's a risk at the same time that they give up some of the legitimacy of an authority that comes with a sort of perceived neutrality. How do you respond to that?
I don't see that we are in post, you know, I see this as a historical continuation. I don't see a distinct trend in what's happening now. Sources, alternative sources have always been around. What they call alternative facts have always been around. There's been a discussion on history of science. This have always been, since, you know, a lot also exaggerated by mass media. Mass media have existed all the time. So in a way, I don't see a particular, something particular about this era to call it post-truth. I think this is just a continuation of a political sphere where you have some war of ideas happen. Scientists and their legitimacy, I don't know what you mean by this. So whether, you know, they have been delegitimized for a long time, in my opinion. Because, okay, let's say you are a scientist, you are both scientists, and you want to publish, and then you go to high impact journal. You begin to like put the stuff that is, you know, that is not right. Implication, future implications that most probably will not be right. Treating this disease, that disease. You can argue, oh, I want just to convince them. No, but we are also involved in this non-factual game. Because this is also part of the propaganda machine. We want to market our research in certain ways. The Human Brain Project in EU is promoted as, you know, understanding the whole brain, simulating the whole brain. No, they are going to simulate a red brain. We know this very well as scientists. But for the public sees, oh, they are going to understand the whole brain. So I think I have to be careful whether we are legitimate or not, or a separate class, but we are involved in the same exercise on a daily basis, where there is a common orthodoxy that people believe in, and just try to see people who go out of the orthodoxy, what happened to them. You have social punishment mechanisms, you don't get grants, you don't get published, so there is already an ambiguous core for what is scientific practice. So I'm not surprised by the trend of what's happening. I think, you know, the right wing have just capitalized on something that already exists in people's mind.
Also, I think the other thing to note is that if you are fit, if you are in a conjecture where people are sort of believing sources which you think not, I don't think the right answer to that is to retreat into this notion of,
yeah,
you know, the pure knowledge versus the other class,
yeah,
knowledge,
yeah,
which is corrupted. It is to sort of try to expose how that operates and how this operates. And the New York Times is also by a biased source in various ways.
Yeah.
Right? It may not actually be sort of unfactual. But, you know, Trump was actually quite right. He mentions in one of his speeches, he says, it's not about the facts, it's about the kind of general tone. That's how it is wrong. And the New York Times has a certain tone, right? You agree with it, or most of us agree with that tone?
Yeah, we tend to check the same sources again and again. And we live in our own, you know, bubble. I check sometimes Breitbart and a lot of right-wing propaganda news, but I don't believe it, but when I don't believe it, I begin to question, is it because of my ideological commitments to certain issues, or because it's not? Right. So that's a question.
I think many things, even at the core of our thinking, like genes, or the way Darwin's theories have been...
So this comes to the last slide. I had some recommended readings. So the first one goes to the idea of the gene, biology as ideology, by Richard Levantine, and some other, you know, a lot of books that from which I got a lot of inspiration for the trends we are seeing. And thank you for coming. I have to end. Thanks.